Church has said, praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Welcome everyone to our Bible study tonight in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Let's have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you for the Bible study. Thank you for your people, our leaders, our workers, our members, our invitees. Thank you because you brought us for a good purpose. And we pray that that purpose will be fulfilled in every life in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Show us your love for us. Show us the sacrifice you made in your love. And let that sacrifice, the shedding of your blood, be effectual, effective in every life in Jesus' name. Open the scriptures to us. Help us to embrace your word, believe your word, and benefit by the word in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Tonight we're studying from John, Gospel according to St. John, reading from verse 1 of chapter 19. John chapter 19, reading from verse 1. Then Pilate therefore took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put on him a purple robe and said, Hail, King of the Jews. And they smote him with their hands. Then we'll read on until we come to verse 17. And he, bearing his cross, went forth into a place called the place of his call, which is called in the Hebrew tongue Golgotha, where they crucified him and two other with him on either side, and Jesus in the midst. We're studying from chapter 19, 1 verses 1 to 22 today, and the title of our subject is the vicarious sacrifice of God's spotless lamb. Vicarious, that means he did it for another. He did it for you and did it for me. He suffered, but the suffering was not for any crime he committed. He suffered, the suffering was not for any sin he had committed. It wasn't for any offense, any fault, or any mistake, or any misdeed of his. It was for us he did it. That's why it's called vicarious. But his sacrifice is a sacrifice of the perfect Lamb of God. It's a sacrifice of the spotless Lamb of God. And it is the sacrifice acceptable to God, perfect in the sight of the Lord, and made propitiation, that is atonement for the sin of everyone in the world. Actually, as you think about the sacrifice, and you think about the Lamb of God, you think about his suffering, you think about his crucifixion, you think about his agony, you think about his pain. This is the lamb that was beaten, the lamb that was mocked, the lamb that was crucified, the lamb that was slain for you and for me. The story of the lamb had been from the Old Testament. And Isaiah seen him coming, referred to him as the Lamb who is to come and is to bear the iniquity, is to bear the punishment, is to bear all the punishment of what we have done. We read in Isaiah chapter 53. Isaiah chapter 53, I'm reading from verse 3. It says, he was despised and rejected of men. As you read the account of the betrayal, and the account of the trial, and the account of the suffering, and the account of the crown of thorns upon his head, and the account of the spear, the account of the sword, and the account of everything they did in the Lord Jesus Christ, you will see that he was pierced and was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we did eat as it were our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Look at what the Gentiles did, those soldiers and those Romans. Look at what Pilate did, and look at what Herod did, and look at what all those Jewish people did. You will see that whether you're Jew or Gentile, you are part of this, and Christ was rejected. But it tells us the reason why in verse 4 it says, surely He has borne our griefs. He has carried our sorrows. That's why it's vicarious. The sacrifice was for us. He did it not for himself. He did it for you. He did it for me. He carried our sorrow. He bore our shame. He carried our punishment. And he bore our penalty. It says in that verse, for yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. Look at verse 5. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was wounded as he placed the crown of thorns on his son. He said, he was wounded as he put the lash and the whips against his back. He was wounded as they nailed him to the cross of Calvary, crucified. He was wounded. It says he was wounded. It's not for himself, for our transgression. That's why it's a vicarious sacrifice. And then it goes on to say he was bruised for our iniquities. It's something he did as a substitute for the sinner, as a substitute for the backslider, as a substitute for every man on the face of the earth. He did it for us. And it says the chastisement of our peace was upon him. With his stripes we are healed. Look at verse 6. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. The Lord laid upon him the iniquity of us all. Vicarious sacrifice of God's spotless lamb. This dates back to Exodus chapter 12, when the children of Israel were going to be redeemed or delivered out of the land of Egypt, when they were going to be brought out, purchased by the blood of the lamb. This was demonstrated at that time because every family was to take a lamb without blemish, a lamb without spot, a lamb without any stain or defilement at all. They were to kill that lamb in the place of everyone so that all the people of Israel would enjoy this protection and this preservation. As the Lord said, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. Exodus chapter 12, I'm reading from verse 3. Exodus chapter 12, verse 3. Speak ye unto all the congregation of Israel, saying, in the 10th day of this month, they shall take to them every man a lamb, every man a lamb, every man a lamb. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All will need to bear the punishment. But if they are not going to bear the punishment, somebody is going to die for them vicariously. That's why it says every man will take a lamb according to the house of their fathers, a lamb for an house. Then it goes on in verse 4, and if the household be too little for the lamb, let him and his neighbor next unto his house take it according to the number of the souls. Every man according to his eating shall take your count for the lamb. It says your lamb in verse 5 shall be without blemish. And they were doing that before Jesus Christ came. It was representative of Christ, a representation of Christ. It was a symbol, something to stand in until Christ came. But the lamb must be without blemish, without any flaw, and without any spot at all. A male of the first year, ye shall take it out from the sheep. And then he goes on to say in verse 12, look at verse 12, for I will pass through the land of Egypt this night, and will smite all the firstborn in the land of Egypt. That is, everyone will die. Remember, once again, even the children of Israel should have died, because whether Jew or Gentile, all have sinned, and all will have to pay the penalty of sin. If they were not going to die, that is the children of Israel, there must be a substitute. Somebody, something must take their place. And it will not be the fruit of the ground like Cain offered. It will be something that has blood, because blood is the life in the living being. And it is that blood he has given for an atonement, he has given for a covering, he has given for cleansing, he has given for the pardon, the chase of the people. And it goes on to say that there'll be judgment in verse 12, the latter part of verse 12, against all the gods of Egypt. I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. Then in verse 13, and the blood the blood of the Lamb, the blood of the spotless Lamb, the blood of the Lamb without blemish shall be to you for a token upon the houses where ye are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. I will know that death has taken place. I will know that something, the Lamb has been your substitute. When I see the blood, I will know that instead of you dying, the Lamb has died for you. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you. When I smite the land of Egypt, it tells us in verse 22, and ye shall take a bunch of hyssop and dip it in the blood that is in the basin, and strike the lintel and the two side posts with the blood that is in the basin, and none of you shall go out at the door of his house until the morning. That is, while judgment will be falling, while judgment will be coming upon everybody in the night, you will say, under the blood, under the blood. And as you stay under the blood, I will know that you are protected by the blood of the Lamb without blemish, without spot, that had died for you. And then in verse 23 it says, for the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians, and when he sees the blood upon the lintel and upon the two side posts, the Lord will pass over that door. It says when he sees that blood, he knows that judgment has taken place, death has taken place. A Lamb, a substitute, died vicariously for everyone in that house. And he says he will not suffer the destroyer, he'll not permit the destroyer to come in onto your houses to smite you. And as you come to John chapter 19, that's what the Lord is demonstrating now. What had been in symbols and what had been in emblems from the Old Testament now is being played out. Now it's going to be the reality, because Jesus Christ is actually the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the whole world. That's what we're told in John chapter 1. John chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 29. John chapter 1, verse 29. The next day, John sees Jesus coming unto him and says, behold the Lamb of God. He saw Jesus Christ, the one who has come to take away our sins. He saw Jesus Christ, the one who is going to take our punishment. He saw Jesus Christ, the blameless one, and the spotless one, and the sinless one, who is going to bear the punishment of the sins of the old world. And he said, behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away. Taketh away. It's not that he's just going to cover the sin and then God will not see it anymore. He's actually going to take the sin away from the heart of every man, from the life of every man. Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world. Look at verse 36, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he says, behold the Lamb of God. Behold the Lamb of God. And you know, we've read Isaiah chapter 53. If you turn to Acts of the Apostles chapter 8, Acts of the Apostles chapter 8, you understand the identification of that Lamb, the Lamb that was slain. You understand the pointing out and the revelation of that Lamb that will take the sin of the world away. Acts chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 30. Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Esaias, and said, understandest thou what thou readest? The man had gone to worship, and then he was still interested. There was still a vacuum in the heart. There was still guilt on the heart. There was still condemnation for the sins he had committed. He wasn't free yet. He didn't feel the joy of serving the Lord. He didn't feel the peace of being related and reconciled with God. He was still searching. He was still reading. And then Philip the evangelist came and said, understandest thou what thou readest? In verse 31, and he said, how can I understand except some man should guide me? How can I understand understand, except some teacher, except some preacher, except some evangelist, except somebody who has got the revelation and who has understood the revelation, will guide me and teach me and lead me to the truth. And he desired Philip that he would come up and see it with him. And the place of the scripture which he read was this: he was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and like a lamb, and like a lamb, and like a lamb dumb before a shearer, so he opened not his mouth. It's the story of Jesus. It's what we're studying today. And it's giving you the reason why Jesus suffered. It's giving you the reason why Jesus paid the utmost price, the greatest price that could be paid, as he went to the cross of Calvary. They questioned him, and he dribbled him, and he lied against him, and he deceived themselves, saying he ought to die. And Pilate said, what have you got to say to this? What have you done? So he opened not his mouth. In his humiliation, verse 33, in his humiliation, his judgment was taken away. There was no justice at all. And who shall declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth. And the eunuch answered Philip and said, I pray you, I plead what you, I'm asking of you, of whom speaketh the prophet this? Of himself or of some other man? He's talking about the lamb. Of whom speaketh the prophet this? He's talking about the lamb before the shearer, and yet you open not his mouth. Of whom does the prophet talk about this? It says Philip opened his mouth and began at the same scripture and preached unto him. Somebody there tell me, Jesus. That's the Lamb of God. And he suffered to take our sins away. The Lord Jesus Christ bore your sin, bore my sin, bore the sin of the whole of humanity. But he did that as the vicarious sacrifice that pleased God in this spotless sacrifice that he made, the Lamb of God. We're reading from 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18. 1 Peter chapter 1, and we're reading from verse 18, talking about our redemption, talking about our salvation, talking about our reconciliation with God, the price of that, the purchase of that, what happened and who paid the price and how was it done. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 18, it says, for as much as she know that she were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers. Look at this, verse 19, but with the precious blood of Christ. You are redeemed by the precious blood of Christ. You are reconciled to God with the precious blood of Christ. Your sins pardoned, your sins cleansed, and your guilt taken away, and the condemnation taken away, and salvation coming to you, and reconciliation with God coming to you. Why and how? With the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot. That's the revelation we're given, that the sacrifice of Jesus was a vicarious sacrifice. It was something he did for you. It was something he did for me. It was something he did for the whole of mankind. He offered himself as a sacrifice for sin, and no other sacrifice could have atoned for all the sins of all the men in the whole world. By his perfect sacrifice, by his acceptable sacrifice, by his sacrifice that he gave on the cross of Calvary, he obtained for us, number one, he obtained pardon. Number two, he obtained peace with God. Number three, he obtained propitiation. That means he obtained favor now. We're under the wrath of God. We're under the indignation of the Lord. But now he's obtained the favor of God by the grace of God. And mercy has come to us. Pardon has come by that sacrifice. Peace has come by that sacrifice. Propitiation has come by that sacrifice. The purging of our heart from sin has come by that sacrifice. Purity has come. Power has come. Now we have power with God, and we have power over all the things that oppressed us before. Perfection has now come because of the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ. Holiness and heaven become ours because of that propitiation, and because of that sacrifice, and because of that vicarious sacrifice of God's spotless, sinless, flawless, faultless Lamb. We're coming into Revelation chapter 7. In Revelation chapter 7, I'm reading here from verse 9. Revelation chapter 7, verse 9. After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude, which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. You see the connection of the Lamb. In whichever nation anybody is, any country anybody is, in any continent anybody is living in, any kind of tongue, any kind of language, any kind of tribe, anywhere, anytime, in all the dispensations and ages of the old world until the end of the world, the only way of salvation and the only way we can have reconciliation with God is through the blood of that Lamb. That's why he says, I beheld, and the number, nobody could tell the number, because they came from all nations and from all kindreds and from all tribes and from all people, from all tongues and languages, and they stood before the throne and before the Lamb. They were clothed with white robes and palms of victory in their hands, and he cried with a loud voice in verse 10, saying, salvation to our God which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb. And all the angels stood round about the throne, and about the elders, and the four living creatures, the beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces, and they worshiped God, saying, amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. Amen. Look at verse 13. And one of the elders answered and said unto me, what are these? Who are these which are arrayed in white robes? And whence came they? And look at this. And I said unto him, sir, thou knowest. And he said unto me, these are they which came out of great tribulation, out of great trial, out of great trouble, out of all the temptation they encountered in the world. And now they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. That's how we receive redemption. That's how we receive salvation. That's how we receive reconciliation with God. And that's how our dirty clothes, our dirty hearts, our dirty mind, that's how our dirty lives are washed and cleansed and made acceptable unto God. It says, therefore are they before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple. And he that sitteth on the throne shall dwell among them. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst anymore, neither shall the sun light on them, nor any heat. For the Lamb, you see, the center of the worship of heaven, and the center of the glory of heaven, and the center of the joy in heaven is the Lamb. And it says, the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them unto living fountains of waters, and God shall wipe all tears away from their eyes. I pray you'll be there. Tonight, as I've told you, we're teaching on the vicarious sacrifice of God's spotless Lamb. Three things we're looking at as we come to John chapter 19. John chapter 19, point number one, the cruelty and the scourging endured by the sinless Savior. The cruelty and the scourging endured by the sinless Savior. That you'll find in John chapter 19, verses 1, 2, 5. Point number two, we have the condemnation and the sentence against the spotless Son, the Son of God, the spotless Son, the condemnation and the sentence against the spotless Son. Point number three, the crucifixion and the suffering of the sinner's substitute. The sinner's substitute is a substitute, and he suffered. Everything he suffered, crucifixion, pain, agony, death, he suffered for you and suffered for me. Point number one now, we have the cruelty and the scourging endured by the sinless Savior. We're coming to chapter 19 of John. I'm reading from verse 1. Then Pilate therefore took Jesus and scourged him. And the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put on him a purple robe. And they said, "Hail, King of the Jews." And they smote him with their hand. Pilate therefore went forth again. He's gone before in chapter 18. But he went forth again and said unto them, unto the Jews, "Behold, I bring him forth to you, that she may know. I bring him forth to you. I show him to you. I reveal him to you now, that she may know that I find no fault in him. I bring him to you that you may know that I find no fault in him." There's a sinless Savior. If you did not find any fault in him, were you scourging him? That's for us. If you did not find any fault in him, why do you put crown of thorns upon his head? That's for us. If you did not find any fault in him, why did he eventually crucify him? That's what was done for us. Look at verse 5. Then came Jesus forth, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, and Pilate says unto them, "Behold the man, behold the man." The cruelty and the scourging endured by the sinless Savior. Isn't he the sinless Savior? Look at the end of that verse 4 again. He said, "I bring him forth unto you that you may know I find no fault in him." He did no evil. He had no sin. He committed no offense. He committed no crime. There was no fault found in him. He spoke nothing amiss. God had no charge against him. No one on earth, no one in heaven condemned him for anything. He hurt no one. He did no harm to anyone. Yet, they crucified him. He did good, only good. He did all things well. He went about doing good, and he went about doing good freely, not asking for reward, not asking for remuneration, not asking for riches, not asking for any recognition. He used his faith to feed thousands, and yet he will not use that faith to feed himself when he was hungry. He was righteous. He was holy. He was good. He was peaceful. He was helpful. He was generous. He was loving. He was perfect. He was sinless. He was spotless. He was blameless. He was faultless. Yet he suffered. Why would such a person suffer? It had been predicted and prophesied. Come to the Old Testament now. Isaiah chapter 50. Isaiah chapter 50. I'm reading here from verse 6. Isaiah chapter 50, we're reading from verse 6. It says, "I gave my back to the smiter, and my cheeks to them that pluck off the ear. I hid not my face from shame and spitting. I hid not my face. They heaped everything upon me, yet not for any offense or any evil that I have done." Why would he do that? How could he do that? To such a spotless one, to such a blameless one, to such a faultless one, and a sinless one, the very Son of God. We're told in Isaiah chapter 53, reading from verse 3, Isaiah chapter 53, verse 3, is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. Nobody even acted as if he knew him. Nobody came to his defense. Nobody came to on his favor. Nobody came on his side. Nobody came to defend him. How about those people that were healed? How about the people, their blind eyes were open? He made the lame to rise up and walk. He cast out the evil spirit. He fed them in their thousands, and he turned their water into wine, and they enjoyed all the miracles that he had performed and done, and none of them showed up. They all hid their faces from him. He was despised, and we did esteem him not. Nobody honored him now. Nobody exalted him now. Nobody came to say something good about him. How could that happen? Verse 4, surely he has borne our griefs. Surely he has carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken. In fact, his smiting of God. How could God smite such a man like that? How could such smite his only begotten Son? Because he was standing in the sinner's place. He was standing on behalf of the sinner. He was suffering the shame and the ignominy that sinners should have gone through. He was bearing the punishment of man. He did it voluntarily. He did it vicariously. He did it of his own free volition. He said, yes, I'll do it for them. And the punishment that should have come on you, come on me. The punishment that should have come on the whole of humanity, God brought everything on him. But he was wounded for our transgressions, and he was bruised for iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes were healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. There was no exception. All we like sheep have gone astray. The high and the low, the men and the women, the parents and the children, the Jews and the Gentiles, the religious and the irreligious, the idol worshiper and the moralist man. It says all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and that's the sin. We've turned everyone from the way of God, from the paths of righteousness, and we've turned every man to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. In verse 7, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers, and yet we're told he's dumb, he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison, that is from place to place and from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. Look at this, look at this. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. We come to Matthew. The Lord Jesus Christ knew the purpose why he came to this world. He knew that this was going to happen, and he didn't shrink from it. He didn't run away from it. He didn't try to avoid it. He didn't try to seek protection for himself, but he went through it because of the punishment that will come upon him. Humanity, and he didn't want that punishment to come on any human being. Therefore, he voluntarily went ahead, even though he knew this ahead of time. He knew it was coming, and yet he went voluntarily to accept it for you and for me. Matthew chapter 20, reading from verse 18. Matthew chapter 20, reading from verse 18. Behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be betrayed unto the chief priests. You see that? He knew he was going to be betrayed. And he says unto the scribes, and they shall condemn him to death. He knew it was coming. He knew it was coming. And he voluntarily bore that. He joyfully bore that. And he vicariously bore that. In verse 19, and shall deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge and to crucify him. And the third day he shall rise again. And so you see that it was not something that he didn't know ahead of time. When eventually he was taken, even Judas Iscariot testified. He said, that man is innocent. Don't mind that I betrayed him when I yielded to the pressure coming from Satan, coming in my heart, and yet I acknowledge him to be innocent. Matthew chapter 27, I'm reading from verse 4. The sinless one, the spotless one, this is the flawless one, and this is the perfect one. Here is a Judas Iscariot saying, I have sinned in that I have betrayed the innocent blood. I have betrayed the innocent blood. Look at verse 19. In verse 19, when he, Pilate, was set down on the judgment seat, his wife sent unto him, saying, have thou nothing to do with that just man? You see, the wife of Pilate also said, is a just one, for I have suffered many things this day in a dream because of him. Look at verse 24. In verse 24, when Pilate saw that he could prevail nothing, but that rather a tumult was made, he took water and washed his hands before the multitude, saying, I am innocent from the blood of this just person. Just person. As Judas Iscariot said, is innocent. And then even Pilate said, he is just. And the wife of Pilate also said, he's a just man. Look at verse 27. In verse 27, and the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the common hall, and he gathered unto him the whole band of soldiers. All the soldiers came together. These were Gentiles now. These were Roman soldiers. But why? Why are you soldiers all there? And what are you gathering for? And look at what he did in verse 28. And he stripped him and put on him a scarlet robe. And it says, when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they put it on his head. He didn't do that gently, a crown of thorns. And then they put it forcefully on his head. And he tore the flesh on the skull. And they put it on his head. And he reed in his hand. And he bowed the knee before him. And they gnawed him and said, "Hail, King of the Jews." That's what he did. And those were the sufferings that he went through. Look at verse 30. And they spit on him. They spit on him, and they took the reed and they smote him on the head. Is the evil sin that he did, and yet he was not guilty of anything. Come to Luke chapter 23. Luke chapter 23, here we're reading from verse 13. Luke chapter 23, verse 13, and Pilate, when he had called together the chief priests and the rulers of the and the people, said unto them, "Ye have brought this man unto me as one that perverteth the people. And behold, I haven't examined him before you. I found no fault in this man, touching those things whereof ye accuse him. I've examined him. I listened to your complaint. I listened to your accusation. I listened to all the things you leveled against him. And I questioned him thoroughly, like a Roman governor could question somebody. And yet I find no fault in him." In verse 15, "No, not yet, Herod, for I sent you to him. And lo, nothing worthy of death is done unto him. I will therefore chastise him and release him." He actually wanted to release him, but no, they will not accept that. Why? Because Christ must suffer. Because Christ must bear your punishment. Because he must bear your evil deeds. In verse 41, it says, and we indeed justly. This is one of the thieves on the cross now talking. "For we receive the due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing amiss." Everybody testified. Everybody, even the thief on the cross, said he has done nothing amiss. In verse 47, "Now when the centurion saw what was done, he glorified God, saying, 'Certainly this was a righteous man.'" Certainly, truly, this was a righteous man. And yet, would you believe that that righteous man, that just man, that innocent man, that one that had no fault at all, he went through all the suffering as if he was the most dangerous person in the land or in the world? The reason why we're told that he did that for you, did that for me, we're told in Hebrews chapter 7. Hebrews chapter 7, just learning about his crucifixion without knowing the reason why, that will not do, that will not suffice. We must know why the Almighty God permitted him to go through everything he went through. And we're told in chapter 7 of Hebrews, reading from verse 25, "Wherefore is able to save them to the uttermost that come to God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them." Verse 26, "For such an high priest became us who is holy." High priest, the one that will atone for our sins. The high priest, the one that will bring reconciliation between us and God. "Such an high priest befitted us, became us, suited us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens." We're coming to 1 Peter chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, the revelation of the reason for his suffering. In 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 22, who did no sin? No, he did no sin. Who did no sin? He did no evil. Who did no sin? He harmed nobody. Who did no sin, either in tongue or in deed or word or action? Who did no sin? Neither was guile found in his mouth. Who, when he was reviled, he reviled not again. And when he suffered, he threatened not, but he committed himself to him that judgeth righteously, who his own self bear our sins in his own body. Who his own self bear our sins in his own body. When they scourged him, himself bear our sins in his own body. When they put the crown of thorns upon his head, himself was the one that bore our own sins in his own body. And when they nailed him to the cross, himself bare our sins in his own body. And when they struck him with a spear, he himself bare our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, might live unto righteousness. We live to righteousness in Jesus' name. And look at chapter 3, verse 18. Chapter 3 of 1 John, verse 18. For Christ also has once suffered for sin, not his own sin, the just for the unjust. The just for the unjust. The righteous for the unrighteous. The sinless for the sinful. Christ also has suffered for our sins, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh and quickened by the Spirit. In 1 John chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 5. In 1 John chapter 3, verse 5, and ye know that he was manifested to take away our sins. That's the reason for it all. That's the purpose of it all. You know, you should know by now. You should know by experience, not just knowing it in the head, not just knowing it in the study, in your own spirit. We know that he was manifested to take away our sins, and in him is no sin. In him is no sin. The Lord is asking you a question in Lamentation chapter 1. Lamentation chapter 1. The question is in verse 12. Lamentation chapter 1. Reading the question the Lord is asking everyone studying this today. Everyone that will ever study this. Everyone that will ever hear about the suffering of the Lord Jesus Christ. The pain of the Lord Jesus Christ. The agony of the Lord Jesus Christ. The vicarious suffering of the Lord Jesus Christ. Here is the question. Lamentation chapter 1, reading from verse 12. Is it nothing to you, all ye that pass by? Is it nothing to you? Is it nothing to you? You have heard about the crucifixion. Is it nothing to you? You have heard about his agony. Is it nothing to you? You have heard about his death, his agonizing death. Is it nothing to you? All ye that pass by, behold and see. If there be any sorrow like unto my sorrow, which is done unto me, wherewith the Lord has afflicted me in the day of his fierce anger. The anger that should have come upon you came upon me, and that agony and that pain came upon me. Is it nothing to you? What have you done about it? What have you done about it? That sacrifice is supposed to atone for your sin. Have you prayed? Have you repented? Have you come to the Lord? Or is it nothing to you? Or do you just read and then you get up and you go back home, and the suffering of Jesus Christ and the agony of Jesus Christ has not done anything for you? Understand, this is the reason for your pardon. This is the reason for your peace. And this is the reason for the covering and for the cleansing of your sin. This is the reason for your purging and for your purity. Is the reason for your power. Is the reason for you having holiness, sanctification. And is the reason for you to get to heaven. Let it be something to you today that you know that Christ has done this for you. And you believe it and you accept it and you embrace it and you hold on to it. You hold fast to it and you praise the name of the Lord, thanking him he gave Jesus for you. We're coming back to John chapter 19. John chapter 19, I'm reading here from verse 6. In John chapter 19, we're reading from verse 6. It says, when the chief priest, therefore, and the officer saw him, they cried out, saying, crucify him, crucify him. Pilate said unto them, take him and crucify him, for I find no fault in him. You take him yourself and crucify him if you want to, because I find no fault in him. The Jews answered him, we have a law, and by our law he ought to die. He must die. He will die, because he made himself the Son of God. When Pilate therefore had that saying, he was the more afraid, and went again into the judgment hall, and says unto Jesus, whence art thou? But Jesus gave him no answer. And then says Pilate unto him, speakest thou not unto me? Knowest thou not that I have power to crucify thee, and I have power to release thee? Jesus answered, he had to answer that one, because this man was claiming the power that belongs to God alone. I have power to crucify you. I have power to release you. I'm the final authority. And when I say crucify him, he's crucified. And when I say, okay, release him, even though the Jews are clamoring for your death, I have the authority and the final power to release you. And Jesus said, thou couldst have no power at all against me, except it be given thee from above. If the Father had not ordained this, if the Father has not appointed this, if the Father has not given a go ahead for this, you couldn't do anything. Therefore, he that delivered me unto thee, who is he that delivered him unto Pilate? That's Caiaphas, that's the high priest. They delivered him because they said, we'll have killed him, but we don't have, our law does not permit to kill any man, so we deliver him into your hand, so you will do that for us. So he said, therefore, he, Caiaphas, that delivered me unto thee, has the greater sin. And from thenceforth Pilate sought to release him, but the Jews cried out, saying, if thou let this man go, thou art not Caesar's friend. Whosoever maketh himself a king speaketh against Caesar. Let's come back to verse 7. In verse 7, the Jews answered him, by we have a law, and by our law he ought to die, because, tell me, because, say it well, because, everybody now, he made himself, he called himself, he showed himself, he revealed himself, he's promoting himself as the Son of God. Well, to start with, these people were not sincere. To start with, they were deliberately ignorant, and they were defiantly ignorant. They were deceptively ignorant. He made himself the Son of God. And because he made himself, nobody has ever said anything like this before, that I am the Son of God, and nobody can support that, and nobody can affirm that, nobody can confirm that, and he just made himself, whatever anybody said, whatever anybody felt, he made himself the Son of God. That's not sincere. We're coming to Psalm 2, and I'm reading from verse 1. We're looking at Psalm 2, verse 1. Why do the heathen rage, and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. He that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh, and the Lord shall have them in derision. Then shall he speak unto them in his wrath, and them expects them in his sore displeasure. Look at this. Yet Almighty God is saying, yet have I set my king upon my holy hill of Zion. I will declare the decree, and the Lord has said unto me, thou art my, everybody, my son, this day have I begotten thee. Now the Jews read the Psalms in their synagogue, in their temple, in their worship, and they know that the Almighty God said, I have set my king upon my holy hill of Zion, and I've said unto my son, thou art my son, this day have I begotten thee. You see, these people, they went to the baptism of John the Baptist, and in Matthew chapter 3, I'm reading from verse 16. As they went, Jesus also went, and John said, are you coming to me? I shall come to you for you to baptize me. And Jesus said, let it be like that. Let's fulfill all righteousness. And Matthew chapter 3 verse 16, and Jesus, when he was baptized, he went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lightning upon him, and lo, a voice from heaven, and lo, a voice from heaven, and lo, a voice from where? Who is talking then? Almighty God Father. It says, and lo, a voice from heaven saying, this is my beloved, everybody, son, in whom I am well pleased. You see why they wanted to kill Jesus? He made himself. He didn't make himself the Son of God. In Psalm 2, this is my son, at this day have I begotten thee. And in Matthew chapter 3, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. They were not sincere. They were deceptively ignorant, and they were defiantly ignorant, and they were deliberately ignorant. Matthew chapter 17, I'm reading from verse 5. Matthew chapter 17, verse 5, while he spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and behold, a voice from the cloud, which said, this is my beloved son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him, don't kill him. Hear ye him, don't despise him. Hear ye him, don't reject him. He is my beloved son, my well-beloved son. I'm well-pleased in him. Hear ye him. We're looking at Luke chapter 1. We're now listening to the testimony of an angel. What an angel said concerning him. You see, these Jews, they were blind. These Jews, they stopped their ears. They will not hear. The evidence was there, and the testimony was there. This is the Son of God. They will not accept. And they said, he made himself the Son of God. Therefore, you must crucify him. Get away. Get him away. Get rid of him. We're looking at Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1 verse 30. And the angel said unto her, fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. And behold, thou shalt conceive in thy womb, and bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name, somebody shout the name, Jesus. He shall be great, and shall be called the Son of the Highest. He shall be called the Son of the Highest. And the Lord God shall give him the throne of his father. He shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end. And then said Mary in verse 34 unto the angel, how shall this be, seeing I know not a man? And the angel answered and said unto her, the Holy Ghost shall come upon thee, and the power of the Highest shall overshadow thee. Therefore also that holy thing which shall be born of thee shall be called, everybody, the Son of God. They said he made himself. He made himself the Son of God. The Heavenly Father called him my son. No, the Heavenly Father said, it's my beloved son. And then on the Mount of Transfiguration, this is my beloved son. I'm well pleased in him. Hear him not. The angel said, he is the Son of God. We've had the angel talking. We've had John the Baptist witnessing that this is the Son of God. We're coming to Matthew chapter 8, and I'm reading from verse 28. Matthew chapter 8, reading from verse 28. And when he was come to the other side of the country of the Gadarenes, there met him two possessed with devils coming out of the tomb, exceedingly fierce, so that no man might pass that by that way. And behold, they cried out. Who are the people crying out here? I said, who are the ones crying out here? The evil spirits is inside those people that possessed them, cried out saying, what have we to do with thee, Jesus, thou, everybody, Son of God? Had thou come to torment, had thou come hither to torment us before the time? Even the evil spirits cried out, and they said, we know who you are. You are the Son of God. And these Jewish people, defiantly ignorant and deliberately ignorant, deceptively ignorant, they said, he made himself the Son of God. We're looking at Mark chapter 3. Mark chapter 3, and I'm reading from verse 11. Mark chapter 3, verse 11. And unclean spirits, when they saw him, fell down before him, and he cried, saying, thou art the Son of God. The unclean spirits, the evil spirits, they cried out, thou art the Son of God. We're reading from Luke chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 40. Luke chapter 4, and I'm reading here from verse 40. In verse 40 it says, now when the sun was setting, all they that had any sick or diverse diseases brought them unto him, and he laid his hand on every one of them and healed them. Look at this. And the devils also came out of many, crying out and saying, tell me, thou art Christ, the Son of God. Thou art Christ, the Son of God. Some of those evil spirits, they call him Jesus, and they say, you are the Son of God. Some of them said, you are Christ, and you are the Son of God. We're coming to John chapter 1. John chapter 1, and we're reading from verse 32. John chapter 1, we're reading from verse 32. Those Jewish people said, Pilate, you know what? He made himself the Son of God. Because of that, he has to die. That's not true. The Father called him Son of God, and the angel called him Son of God. Even the evil spirits and the demons, devils, called him the Son of God. Everybody that knew anything about him knew, this is the Son of God. Now in John chapter 1, reading from verse 32. John chapter 1, verse 32, and John bear record saying, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it abode on him, and I knew him not. I didn't know his identity. I didn't know his supernatural power. I didn't know where to place him, and I knew him not. But he that sent me to baptize with water, the same said unto me, upon whom thou shalt see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, the same is he which baptizeth with the Holy Ghost. And I saw and I bear record that this is, everybody, the Son of God. How could the Jews miss this? They were there when he was baptizing, and they should have known. Heaven called him the Son of God. The Spirit came upon him to affirm, to confirm that this is the Son of God. I'm reading here now from verse 47. I'm reading from verse 47. When Jesus saw Nathanael Nathanael, chapter 1 of John, verse 47. Jesus saw Nathanael coming unto him and says unto him, behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom is no guile. Nathanael says unto him, whence knowest thou me? Jesus says, and Jesus answered and says unto him, before that Philip called thee, when thou was under the fig tree, I saw thee. Nathanael answered and said unto him, Rabbi, thou art who? The Son of God, thou art the King of Israel. He was not the one that proclaimed to Nathanael, I'm the Son of God. Yet by force you must accept me as the Son of God. He knew by inspiration, he knew by revelation, you are the Son of God. We're coming to Matthew chapter 16. Matthew chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 15. In Matthew chapter 16, reading from verse 15, here he said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? The Lord Jesus Christ now asked his own disciples, whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Look at everybody affirming that. Everybody confirming that. Everybody embracing that. Thou art the Son of the living God. Jesus answered and said unto him, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. It was revelation from heaven. And yet these Jews said he made himself the Son of God. And just because of that, they wanted to crucify him. In John chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 25. John chapter 11, we're reading from verse 25. Jesus says unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. Whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? And she, this is Martha, and she saith, this Martha answering, and she says unto him, yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, tell me, the Son of God, which should come into the world. They were expecting that the Son of God should come into the world. Now he has come into the world. And the Jews said, crucify him. The Jews said, get rid of him, because he made himself the Son of God. He didn't make himself the Son of God. He was the Son of God. Heaven confirmed it. And even hell confirmed it. And earth confirmed it. In Matthew chapter 27 verse 54. Matthew chapter 27 verse 54. Now when the centurion and they that were with him watching Jesus saw the earthquake and those things which were done, they feared greatly, saying, truly, certainly, without any shadow of doubt, truly, this was the Son of God. Even the centurion that's in the Roman army, he said, truly, this was the Son of God. Why are we reading all this? Why are we affirming all this? John chapter 20. John chapter 20. Reading from verse 30 and verse 31. And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that she might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. This has been written, and this we're studying, that you might know, that you might believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and in believing you will have life. That's a man persecuting the church, there was a man blaspheming the Lord, there was a man that was a very injurious, a murderer, and a blasphemer. And then he had an encounter with the Lord Jesus Christ on the road to Damascus. The light shone all his darkness vanished away. And without anybody coming to convince him or to talk to him about who Jesus was, when he came out of that visitation from heaven, look at what he said in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 9. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 9. I'm reading here from verse 19. It says, and when he had received meat, he was strengthened, then saw certain days, then was saw certain days with the disciples, which were Damascus, and straightway he preached Christ in the synagogues that he is, who is he? The Son of God. There's somebody who had been persecuting and committing those people to prison, even to die. And now when he came to the knowledge of the truth and the light, he said, now I know the truth. Now you know the truth. I said, now you know the truth, that Jesus is the Son of God. We're coming back to John chapter 19. I'm coming to point number 3 now. The crucifixion and the suffering of the sinner's substitute. Crucifixion and suffering of the sinner's substitute. I'm reading from chapter 19, John chapter 19, and we're reading from verse 13. When Pilate therefore heard that saying, he brought Jesus forth, and he sat down in the judgment seat in a place that is called the pavement, which in the Hebrew tongue is called Gabbatha. And then it goes on to say in verse 14, and it was the preparation for the Passover. And about the sixth hour, it says unto the Jews, behold your king. But they cried out, away with him, away with him, crucify him. Pilate says unto them, shall I crucify your king? And the chief priest answered, we have no king but Caesar. And he delivered him therefore unto them to be crucified. And they took Jesus and led him away. And he bearing his cross went into the place that is called, the place of his skull, which is called in the Hebrew Golgotha, where they crucified him and two other with him, on either side one, and Jesus in the midst. Pilate wrote a title and put it on the cross, and the writing was Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. This title then read many of the Jews, for the place where Jesus was crucified was nigh to the city. And it was written in Hebrew and Greek and Latin. It says, then said the chief priests of the Jews to Pilate, write not the King of the Jews, but that he said, I am the King of the Jews. Even after crucifixion, their hatred still continued. Pilate answered, what I have written, I have written. What I have written, I have written. Well, we have learned about the suffering of Christ. We have learned about the crucifixion of Christ. But the question is, why all this? Why was he crucified? It's so that he'll be your savior. He'll be my savior. He'll be the savior of the whole world. He suffered not for himself. He suffered as a substitute. Everything he went through, he did for us. He did for us. He suffered for us. He bore the shame for us. He was nailed to the cross for us. Look at those two words, for us, for us, for us. Look at Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 8. But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died, tell me, for us. Christ died for us. You must understand, the death should have died, Christ has borne that. Much more than in verse 9, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. It tells us in Romans chapter 8, verse 32, he did this all for you, all for me, all for us. Romans chapter 8, verse 32, he that spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, for us all. He delivered him up for your sin, for your evil, for your crime, so that you can be forgiven. Delivered him up for us all. How shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Is so that you'll possess all things. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 7. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7. For us, he did it. For us, he paid the price. For us, he suffered. For us, he bled. For us, he died on the cross. It says in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, put out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened. Look at this. For even Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed, tell me, for us. Sacrificed for us. You cannot miss that. It for your sin, he died. For your crime, he died. And because he died for your sin, and because he died for your crime, you can come and take refuge under the blood of the Lamb. Seek forgiveness under the blood of the Lamb. And seek reconciliation under the blood of the Lamb. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I'm reading from verse 3. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we're reading from verse 3. It says in verse 3, for I delivered unto you first of all, that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins. You see that? He died for your sins. He died for your crime. He died for your iniquity according to the scriptures. And that he was buried and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, we're reading from verse 21. All this he did for you. He did for your salvation. He did for your sanctification. He did for your righteousness. He did for your reconciliation with God. He did so that you will not perish. And if you'll accept and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ today, knowing that he has borne your shame and he has borne your punishment, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Salvation is available today. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21. For he has made him to be sin for us. For us. He has made him to be sin, to be the sin offering for us, to be the substitute for us, to be the sacrifice for us, and to be the atonement for every one of us. For he has made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Ephesians chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 2. Ephesians chapter 5, reading from verse 2. And walk in love, as Christ also has loved us and has given himself for us. He has given himself for us. You cannot miss that. It's on the pages of the New Testament. He was crucified because of you. He died because of you. He bore the agony because of you. He paid the penalty because of you. He said Christ has given himself for us an offering and a sacrifice to God for a sweet smelling savor. Titus chapter 2, we're reading from verse 14. Titus chapter 2, we're reading from verse 14. It says, who gave himself for us. You see that? He repeats it over and over so that you will not miss it. He gave himself, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity. Every iniquity you have perpetrated, every crime you have done, you have committed, every sin you have committed, already he suffered for that. And then he said that he might purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. What he has done for you will be yours in Jesus' name. Salvation, yours in Jesus' name. Cleansing, yours in Jesus' name. We're looking at Hebrews, Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9, I'm reading from verse 12. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 12. Neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood, he entered in once into the holy place. Look at this. Having obtained eternal redemption for us. Having obtained by his death, by his sacrifice, he has obtained eternal redemption for us. Look at verse 24. In verse 24, for Christ has not entered into the holy places made with hands, which are the figures of the truth, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God, tell me, for us. To appear in the presence of God. And he did that for us. As we look at Galatians chapter 1. Galatians chapter 1, reading from verse 4. He says, who gave himself for our sins. He gave himself. Everywhere it's clear. It's not for his own sins. It's not for his own crime. He had none. He had no fault. He was sinless. And he was pure. He was perfect, but for our sins he died. He gave himself for our sins. And then he says that he might deliver us from this present evil world according to the will of God our Father. And now he's been saying for us, for us, for us. But now it's going to be personal. For
me.
He died for He shed his blood for
me.
He provided salvation for
me.
He provided sanctification for
me.
He removed judgment for
me.
He's gone to heaven for
me.
For me. For me. For me. I said for me. You must be saved. For
me.
Your guilt must go away. For
me.
Every burden of sin, every punishment and load is taken away from you. He did it for me. Look at it in Galatians chapter 2. Galatians chapter 2 verse 20. Galatians chapter 2 verse 20. I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. Christ liveth in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. I believe he's the Son of God. I hold him to be the Son of God. I embrace him to be the Son of God. I understand he's the Son of God, my Savior. Say it for yourself. Who loved me and gave himself for me. He gave himself for me. As they surrendered him to Pilate, why was he going? Because of me. As they put the crown of thorns on his head, why didn't he complain? For me. As they put all the lashes upon him, why didn't he run away from that? For me. And then we are told tonight, he could have come legions of angels to deliver him. He could have escaped. Why didn't he call those angels? Because he stayed there. He bore it for me. All the eternal judgment of God that should have come upon your life, he stayed there. He bore everything. He loved me and he gave himself for me. Everybody, he loved me and he gave himself for me. Salvation is available for you. Sanctification available for you. Healing available for you. Heaven available for you. He died for you. you will not perish. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. He did that for you. He did that for you. He gave himself for me. He loved me. He loved me. He loved me and gave himself for me. Gave himself for me. Gave himself for me. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Salvation is yours. Holiness is yours. Heaven is yours. Everything he bought, everything he purchased on the cross of Calvary is yours today. Believe and you will receive.